Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the EdiSight Network. Today, we are going to discuss the marketing strategies in services sector. And this is a two-part series where the first part will be covered today. And this is part of an ongoing broader series on services marketing that we've been conducting with our subject expert, Professor Ravi Shankar. Welcome, sir. Dr. Ravi Shankar is a professor in the Indian Institute of Foreign Trade. He is also a senior consultant on the panel of Commonwealth of Learning, Vancouver, Canada. Thank you for being here, sir.
Thank you. So, friends, as you are aware that for the last couple of months, we started this series on marketing in the services sector. And we discuss various issues in this regard. In fact, we have already done roughly 9 or 10 such interactions. And today is the last but one, and tomorrow is the last one. And we are trying to now wind up and look at in some kind of a strategic perspective. When you talk of strategy, strategy is always long term. The difference between strategy and the other thing is tactical. The strategic or tactical, there are two different aspects. Tactic is something which you do situationally. Strategy is always long term. And not only the meaning of strategy is that not only you have an objective, but also you develop a roadmap. How do you achieve those objectives? Many a times when you follow the roadmap, you come across certain hurdles. How you come across those hurdles, that become part of your tactical thing. It's simply, you know, the kind of expressions I have used, roadmap and the hurdles or the roadblocks. You would look at as if you are going on a highway or on your from your home to your office. You know that the distance between your home and your office is it takes you about half an hour. Normally you make point that you keep a margin of 5 minutes or 7 minutes, and 35 minutes, 40 minutes ahead of the you know, in advance you start off. But suddenly you find there is a traffic jam. Now normally you're take your motorcycle on the road, but since there is a traffic jam, you put your motorcycle on the footpath. Now that footpath is a tactical thing. You go against the traffic. At times you go in the wrong direction, but you make a point to reach your office on time. So these are all, we call it tactical. So tactical and strategic, they all gel together. Nevertheless, you cannot plan something which is tactical in advance. And therefore, what you plan is strategy. And that is what we want to discuss today, marketing strategies in the services sector. A lot of marketing managers were asked, what is the meaning of it? And some people gave their understanding in the following way. Somebody said it is a long-term activity. Others said it provides us an overall achievement of our objectives. The third one said it provides a broad plan of action. The fourth one said it helps us to sell as large quantities as possible. And others said it helps us to maximize profits. Well, marketing strategy is a combination of all five and not one. It's like, you know, four blind people trying to figure out an elephant. So if I put it together, one simple way to look at marketing strategy is the selection of a course of action. The way I say that you are going from your home to your office and you develop a course of action to reach your office on time. So it's a selection of course of action from among several alternatives that involve specific customer groups, communication methods, distribution channel, and pricing structure. And it's a combination of target markets and marketing mixes. So this is what a very simple definition or description has been given about marketing strategy. And that implies that we look at target markets as a very important element, that which market segments you would like to cater to. Everybody in the marketplace is not the target segment. A company which is coming out with a wristwatch with a teddy bear or Donald Duck on it, definitely that wristwatch is not meant for somebody who is getting married, somebody who is working in the corporate sector. But this kind of a wristwatch is meant for children, because children would like to have the Cartoon Network characters on their wristwatches. So maybe that is where I call it, is in that backdrop, target segment, market segment is one of the very first steps of developing a marketing strategy. A target market is a market segment selected by the organization for marketing attention, that you will target all your marketing activities for that market segment. Why? Because market segments involve dividing customers into groups, which is market segment, with common characteristics and possible common wants. I am now introducing another concept called wants. Here it is important for you to understand there is something called needs and wants. Needs are common, but wants are socio-culturally oriented. Let's pick up an example. The example is around lunchtime, 1 o'clock, each one of us, we feel like eating something, we are hungry. So the need for food is common need across India. But somebody who is in down south would like to prefer to eat something which is very different from what a North Indian would like to eat during the lunchtime. So the wants, what I want to eat is different from what my South Indian friend would want to eat. So wants are socio-culturally oriented. And that is where when we say the segmentation, segmentation means that you divide the market into homogeneous groups with an assumption that the common people will have common requirements, they will want specific things from the company. And if the company can provide that, obviously the company will be able to achieve, you know, sales, profits from that market segment. So it is in that backdrop and an understanding of a target market is essential or is necessary. In the marketing literature, four basic approaches of marketing strategy has been proposed, and in today's interaction I'm going to explain all the four step by step. And today's session will go around only these four approaches, and tomorrow we will go a little more further and talk about other aspects of marketing strategy, and then develop maybe much clearer idea about the meaning of marketing strategy in the context of services sector. The first approach of marketing, so in marketing literature, people talk about marketing mix as a basis of marketing strategy, which means each element of the marketing mix must be seen with a long-term perspective. The second is product life cycle as a basis of marketing strategy, that each product, each company's market offer goes through a life cycle. And at each stage of the life cycle, differential marketing strategies are required. The third approach is positioning as a basis of marketing strategy, which means that what value proposition you are offering, an entire marketing program is structured around the value proposition. And finally, the fourth approach is market share and competition as a basis of marketing strategy, that you look at where you are as against the competitor. And then based on that, you decide what kind of market strategy you will have, understanding as against competition, where do you stand. So these are the four basic approaches which have been proposed. I know it may not be very clear to you at this stage, but as I discuss step by step, all the four points will become clearer to you. So let us now move to the first approach, which is marketing mix as a basis of marketing strategy. A lot of researchers have suggested that each element of the marketing mix must be seen with a strategic perspective. For example, product. What is your product strategy? Nokia as a company had a poor product strategy. As a result, they lost market share. I gave this example yesterday that in 2011, in the Indian market, 657 handsets were launched. Nokia launched only 15 handsets, and out of the 657, such a huge number, even companies like Carbon, Mumba, Max, Lava, they launched more than 35 handsets. They gained market share, but Nokia didn't introduce dual SIM. Nokia didn't introduce Android phones in the market, and they lost market share. And that is where we say that product strategy, your product strategy also has to be the right strategy. Pricing strategy. Today, actually, the Indian market is a highly price-sensitive market. Why Duster is successful in the Indian market is only because of the reason. It is price. Because it has low price, so it is so successful. So product strategy, price strategy, distribution strategy, or advertising or promotion strategy. So any element of the marketing mix you select, that has to be seen with a long-term perspective. Within each marketing mix element, there could be further dimensions also. Like in distribution, you talk about customer service. Now, after-sale service is a very important element. Large number of companies, particularly in consumer durables sector, they look at after-sale service as a very important strategic element. LG or other companies, they provide superior after-sale service and they have eroded the market of others. In fact, if you pick up the, take the example of air conditioners in the Indian market, Carrier Aircon was the market leader maybe 25 years ago. Where is Carrier Aircon today? And who is the market leader? Obviously, there is a other company. And how they eroded it, looking at their marketing strategy, within the marketing strategy, they looked at customer service, after-sales service, as a very important element of winning the customers. It's being said in the marketing in marketing that the way technology has excelled, that companies have become virtually contorts to deliver added value to the customers. Today you may find that some cars are being manufactured and in the same plant, and they some of the cars, they look almost alike. Nissan and Renault's cars in India, they look almost alike because they are manufactured and assembled under the same roof. It could be that some of the cars may have the same engine. Actually, three or four models have the same engine. So if the engine is the same, it's only the design looks different. How you can compete is only after-sales service. Here is a company which provides superior after-sales service. And that is what somebody said, that physical products have become contorts to deliver added value to the customer. And this added value can only be delivered through superior after-sales service. So even within the marketing mix, one sub-element called customer service is seen with a long-term perspective as a strategic perspective. And that is what the meaning here is. And various researchers and authors, I brought some of their quotes in my presentation. And Foxwell defined marketing strategy as being an indication of how each element of the marketing mix will be used to achieve the marketing objective. Foxwell even further, and then others said that a range of marketing component strategies, the Chang and Campbell and Flores, they talked about a range of marketing component strategies which constitute the total marketing strategy, like product strategy, distribution strategy, sales promotion strategy, pricing strategy, and so on. Large number of companies are looking at managing their prices. Even if the excise goes up on some of the products, companies still hold back the prices. They don't increase their prices because they know if the prices go up, they will lose market share and so on. And here in the services sector, when we talk about 8 P's of marketing, you know, even the strategies which you have, the like product strategy, price strategy, play strategy, promotion strategy, physical evidence strategy. A lot of restaurants, for example, they go for renovation because they know how the appeal has become, you know, rather dull, rather people are fed up with the same decor. So they refurbish the restaurant, they redo up the restaurant. It still remains the Chinese restaurant, but the decor changes. And that is where we call it physical evidence strategy, process of delivery. Now, a lot of innovations have been done in process delivery. Look at the retail banking. In retail banking, so many innovations have taken place, starting from the token system to the teller system to the ATM. Now, the three generations of processes we have seen in the retail banking. And it didn't happen by default. It was a strategic move, definitely, in the banking sector, where they try to integrate information and communication technology to deliver better service to the people. So is could be the productivity strategies. Large number of airlines across the globe, they are faced with this challenge, how to increase their productivity. Some of the airlines like Emirates, Etihad and so on, they use their global presence, in the strategic location, and they can connect from one side to Australia to the United States or Canada on the other side of the globe. And they use their location as a very strategic dimension, and that is where their productivity is very high. And honestly speaking, that these airlines are really getting into making profits in a big, big way. They recover the cost of an aircraft within 3 to 5 years' time. They modernize their fleet. They discard their old aircrafts, and they have the best aircrafts in their fleet and whatnot. And our national carrier, for example, the Air India, I was told, I don't know how far that is correct, where the global standards are close to 16 to 17 hours of flying time of an aircraft. Our national airlines has about 10 to 11 hours. And that is where the productivity strategies, they have to revamp their productivity strategies. Otherwise, this airline will not make profits. It will continue to be on a life support system where the subsidies are given by the government. Then you look at people, what type of people you recruit. So these are all different elements of the marketing mix, and each element of the marketing mix must be seen with a strategic perspective. So with that, we move to the next, which is positioning as a basis of marketing strategy. And that is the second approach of marketing strategy, that what value proposition you have. Each brand is perceived differently by people. People perceive something out of it, and that is what you communicate that in the market. The father of modern day advertising, David Ogilvy, he said that you should not be thinking of USP, unique selling proposition, because unique selling propositions can be diluted because others can imitate it. You put 4 blades on the ceiling fan rather than 3, others put it. You put a light, others imitate it, they put also the light. You convert fan into a kind of a chandelier, others also do it. You make blades out of wood, they also do it. You replace the metal with brass, so they also replace steel with brass. And David Ogilvy 50 years ago, or maybe longer than that, he said, reach out to the minds of the people. Take a slot in people's mind. You position the product in minds of the people. Once you get positioned in people's mind, you take a slot in people's mind, it may be difficult for your competitor to dislodge that position. So that is where the positioning came in. And subsequently, Al Reese and Jack Trout, they supplemented and they said, yes, in the positioning era, you position the product in the minds of the people. So the scope and the meaning of positioning has two dimensions. And because if you read more, you may get confused. So I thought, let me remove that confusion right away. The positioning has two connotations. Wind and Kleekamp, they explain a product positioning as its overall situation in the market relative to its sales, market share and profitability. Which is discussed actually in my presentation as the fourth option, which is your competition, industry position as a marketing strategy. But for our understanding, we are going by the description given by the gentleman, Crevens. He is positioning as being the selection of a marketing strategy from a range of alternatives, although the latter can be considered to be components part of the corporate strategy as developed by Ansouf. Here the meaning is that the company investigates the segmentation of a particular market. Historically, here is a company which looked at that large number of women in this country. They identify themselves with this lady called Lalitaji. Lakhs of women still in this country, you may find their cosmetics doesn't go beyond a bindi, their dress code doesn't go beyond a cotton sari, their jewelry doesn't go beyond a Mangal Sutra, their footwear doesn't go beyond a leather chappal, and lakhs of these women are seen haggling for prices at a vegetable shop. So that is a segment which is realistic, and here is a company which thought that let us position the product, a detergent, to this woman, which is, "Hey, bhaiya, theek se tolo, sarf ki khareedari mein hi samajhdari hai." I am not promoting the detergent, please don't misunderstand me. Just for the sake of clarification, I am saying that company looked at a segment and targeted at that it is wiser, because surf sasta detergent surf ke aadha kilo ke barabar hota hai, and that is where they said that the greater value for money, and surf ki khareedari mein hi samajhdari hai. Now these kind of communications and advertisements, they talked about here is a segment and here is a value proposition, and that you are wiser, and people identified themselves with this, and obviously it really worked in the marketplace. So that example I really took to explain my point, and from there we draw the meaning that positioning is the development of a service of a marketing mix to occupy a specific place in the minds of the customers or within the target market. You look at a specific target segment and create imageries in their mind. So the importance in the marketing literature has been given to positioning for variety of reasons, and the three main reasons are perceptual process of customers. They screen out most information. They screen out information, they analyze it, they filter it, and they synthesize it. And then there is a greater competition, more organizations competing for the same share of mind. Everybody is trying to reach out to the same slot, and therefore it is better for you to decide and develop a strategy to be superior than the competitors in achieving that value proposition. And the growing volume of commercial messages, because there is a clutter of advertisements and promotions, and therefore you have to do it very wisely, very carefully, not only to stand out of the crowd, but also have much greater believability, so that people believe in what you say and not people reject what you say. So here the suggestion is that your positioning can actually have three alternate strategies. Number one, single target market strategy, or concentrated marketing strategy, or full coverage marketing strategy. And historically, in the services sector, they say that you may position the product in six different ways. And the first is specific product features. Here is a product which has a feature, and you position the product on the feature, like Diet Pepsi or Diet Coke. Now here is a product which doesn't have sugar, and you have just low calorie, one calorie or one, so on. So you position the product on specific product features. It's also being said in marketing, people don't buy features, they buy benefits. So the second option is given is that you structure your communication, you position yourself on benefits. Why somebody will buy a cotton wrinkle-free shirt? Because it's good to wear in hot, sultry weather. So that is the benefit, that it is comfortable, it looks fresh even at 4 o'clock, because it doesn't get crushed at 4 o'clock. It's a cotton but wrinkle-free shirt. The third is specific usage occasion, that you use the product at a particular time. So specific usage occasion, and there are companies which came out with a, you know, call it party wear. Now the party wear is for the parties and not for office wear. But there was a company which came out with a sub brand called 9to5 shirts, and 9to5 shirts were all plain in color, very light in color, you know, light yellow, very light gray, very light green, very light mustard color and so on, or white, off-white. And they were generally full sleeve kind of shirts and 9-to-5 shirts, which is a sub-brand they created, and they became very popular actually. The fourth option is user category. Now, user category is like choice of new generation. In fact, this is a classic example that Pepsi challenge and targeting at youth, it became a very popular campaign, and it eroded the market of Coca-Cola by 3% when Pepsi challenge was initiated some years ago. Then the fourth is you position yourself against a product. So you position yourself against competition, and you come out with comparison advertisements and so on. And finally, we call it product class disassociation, that you say that it is not milk, but you try to dissociate yourself from the product class, but like skimmed milk is advertised in many, many countries in a very, very different way. And it is projected, it is good, it is full of nutrition without all that fat. So it gives you nutrition. In United States, actually, this campaign was done, skimmed milk, what a surprise campaign, was a very successful campaign in United States, because they found that people are using more of the soft drinks and junk food and getting overweight. So they thought there is a need to promote nutrition and nutrition value of milk. And they came out with milk, what a surprise campaign, and the campaign was very, very successful. And the chances of getting overweight really came down significantly in the United States. So these are typically, we say, are the positioning options in the manufacturing sector, and some of the people, they use it in the services sector also. But when we come to the services sector, we call that in the services sector, there is a need to look at corporate positioning. Service sector is one such sector where the image of the organization becomes extremely important. You don't go by a particular service. You may say such and such hospital is a good hospital. When you say such and such hospital is a good hospital, it is your judgment is on every service which is rendered, whether it is OPD, whether it is pathological lab, or it could be radiology lab, it could be the surgery, is the post-operative care, everything. So you put say it, such and such hospital is very good, such and such bank is very good, such and such restaurant is very good. So service organization, such an airline is very good. You just can't say that where is an airline whose international routes are very good, whose national routes are so-so, and whose trunk routes are so-so, and feeder routes are terrible. Now, you just talk about corporation, or similarly insurance company. That uska medical insurance acha hai, dusra insurance acha nahi hai. So here in the service sector, typically you talk about the organization, and therefore the corporate positioning issues become far more obvious and far more significant in the services sector, because service organizations are seen as corporations. They are not seen as brands. The difference is, here is a company called Unilever. They may have a brand of detergent which is Surf Excel. They have another brand of detergent called Wheel. They may have a third brand of detergent which is Rin. So three brands are positioned separately. Cigarette company ITC might have 50 brands of cigarettes. Each brand is positioned separately. But in the services sector, it's the corporation. The corporate positioning is far more significant. So that is the difference when you talk of branding in services versus the manufacturing sector. So here, the positioning options are not in line with what we just discussed, those six things like specific product features, benefits, usage category, or so on. It can be, it might be, but more categorically in the services sector, these 12 service positioning options, they are more relevant. In fact, if you look at the first strategy is market share leader. You are the biggest. The fact is Indian Railways is the largest organization, largest organized manpower in this country after Indian Army or Indian Defense. But whether they project them like this, perhaps not, and there is a need for them to say it. The Indian Postal Department is the second largest organized manpower, but they don't project them like that. And therefore, there is a need for these organizations to project on market share leader. They have the largest share of employment in this country. In fact, Indian Railway is the largest organized manpower in this country, and the second largest is, of course, the Department of Post. So you can position your organizations on the biggest, you're the largest. Life Insurance Corporation is the largest financial institution in this country. State Bank of India is the largest banking institution in this country. But do they project themselves like this? Perhaps no. And I think there is a scope for them to promote themselves on these lines the way I have suggested. Let us move to the second. The second option is quality leader, best and the most reliable. Now, when it comes to buying, whose quality is better? When you travel internationally, who gives you better quality? When you are taking a housing loan, who gives you better quality of loan and reliability in terms of speed, accuracy, efficiency, interest rate and whatnot? So what are the perceptions? The perceptions of quality are very important. Yesterday I was discussing that. So the best and the most reliable. If you have to send money to somebody, how you will send that money and which kind of institution you will go to transfer the money. So that is where, you know, in many sectors the quality comes in. And the second, therefore, the corporate positioning option is quality leader, that your company comes out with quality services and you project yourself as the quality leader. The third corporate positioning option is the service leader, that you are the company which is most responsive to the customer's problem. You handle customer problems with enormous detail. You handle customers with personal care and you give them the personal attention. So some service companies, they even get into that kind of situation, and they position themselves as the service leader, that we extend the maximum and the best service to our people. Some of the mobile phone companies, they are doing it, that we are the best in providing service. You dial 121 or 111 or whatever the number is for helpline and you get the immediate redressal of your grievances. So you project themselves yourselves as a service leader. Courier companies are projecting themselves as a service leader. Healthcare companies are projecting themselves as a service leader. Insurance companies are projecting. Actually, recent advertisements of Max New York Life is actually on service leader. That somebody says, I have changed my house and can you change on my records? So, you know, they are trying to project themselves on the service leader. How far they are successful, how far they are not successful, that's a separate issue of debate. I am just giving examples in the context of the option. So whether Max New York Life is successful in achieving or not, it depends on the efforts they put in. So it's a matter of debate. But I am just giving an example to substantiate my point that there are 12 options you have and you can choose out of that, which are very, very different from the 6 options which typically a manufacturing organization has as far as positioning is concerned. So the third option for service organization is to position themselves as a service leader which is most responsive to customer problems, and you handle customer problems very effectively. The fourth corporate communication option is technology leader, that you develop new technologies first. Apple is able to do it, and they say that we are the technology leader. We did develop new technologies. Other, they imitate it, they copy it, they take it. In fact, they filed a legal suit also against somebody, some another company, and so on. So they wanted to not only maintain but protect that against competitors. So a technology leader, first to develop new technologies. The fourth is innovation leader, that you are more creative in applying new technologies. So the fifth corporate positioning option is innovation leader, most creative in applying new technologies. Here I would like to give the example of information and communication technology being integrated into the retail banking sector. Come what may, our nationalized banks, they have been rather slow in integrating information and communication technology in their retail banking operations. If it is Maharashtra, they may have a bank called Bank of Maharashtra, but in Maharashtra you may not find too many ATM counters of Bank of Maharashtra. Bank of Baroda might be a bank from Gujarat, and you may not find many ATM counters of Bank of Baroda in Gujarat. Andhra Bank might be the bank for Andhra Pradesh, and in Andhra Pradesh you may not even find many ATM counters of Andhra Bank. Punjab and Sindh Bank or Punjab National Bank might be the banks from Punjab, but you may not find many ATM counters of these banks in Punjab. State Bank of Bikaner and Jaipur may be the bank which is from Rajasthan, but you may not find many ATM counters of this bank or Bank of Rajasthan in Rajasthan. Friends, the examples I am picking up to substantiate that whose ATM counters you come across more often, and that is actually ICICI. Now here is a financial institution in this country, which is Industrial Credit and Investment Corporation of India, which came into retail banking also, and they integrated the information and communication technology and spread out their network of ATM counters across India and gained market share. Similarly, there was another, which was Housing Development Finance Corporation of India, which later on became, when they came into the retail banking, HDFC Bank, and they fanned through the geographical territories of this country to have a huge network of the ATM counters and thereby gaining the market share. So these banks I would call innovation leaders in terms of integrating information and communication. They didn't invent the technology, but they integrated the technology. So you are the first to integrate new technologies. More you are progressive, more you grow actually. And these are just the examples I'm having to substantiate that these banks are really, really the innovation leaders in integrating the new technologies into the retail banking operations. The sixth corporate positioning option is flexibility leader, that you are adaptable. I am told that you can even tell this company to put together a computer as far as your specifications are concerned, and they prepare the machine according to your specifications. So here is a company which is a flexibility leader, that they are able to prepare a machine as per your specifications. The seventh corporate positioning option is relationship leader. The relationship leader means that you are committed to the customer success. In fact, some of these courier companies, FedEx, DHL, they grew over a period of three decades. In 70s and 80s, they were in logistics services. They were looking at documents. Then they realized that documents is a very small element. The non-document segment is a huge segment. And these companies, they ventured into non-documents transportation. And they really realized that this non-document, which is consignments, is a really big business. And subsequently, they grew into logistic partners. Today, they tell large number of companies, you need not to have your godowns, you need not to have your warehouses, you need not to have your fleet of trucks. You pass on your logistic requirements to us. We will be your logistic partner and provide you the logistic service as per the agreement which you and we agree upon. And these companies have gone into the relationship leader, And a lot of IT companies have gone into that kind of a situation. And that is the seventh corporate positioning option. The eighth is prestige leader, most exclusive. There are clubs in the city of Delhi, which to become a member of that club is actually a prestige. Even getting a credit card of American Express, you have to pay actually every year to retain this kind of a card, and there is a subscription fee. Majority of that credit cards are actually free, and you actually earn points. But here is a card. If you are an international traveler and you don't want to run into any kind of a problem, and you don't mind paying a small fee of about $10 a year or $100 a year, $100 a year. So you don't mind getting this. So it's actually a prestige. So that is the eighth corporate positioning option, which is prestige leader. The ninth corporate positioning option is knowledge leader, which is that you are best expertise in the industry, in that technology. It could be a management function like HR or finance or any of those. So I have taken two sectors and I picked up two examples here. A company like Ernst & Young, they are knowledge leader in a particular sector. Accenture, they specialize in another sector. PricewaterhouseCoopers, they specialize in another sector. These are all consulting companies, but in the consulting in a particular knowledge domain, they excel. In healthcare sector, for example, it's very interesting. In India particularly, we find we have hospitals which could be only looking at renal or eye or cancer or cardiac, heart or spinal injury or any other thing, skin related. So you do have these 7-8 types of at least hospitals in the city of Delhi, and I find that they have developed expertise to such a level that it's difficult for others to match that level of expertise in that domain. So that is the positioning they have been able to create for themselves, the knowledge leader, that they have the best expertise in that domain. The ninth corporate positioning option is the global leader. If you have to fly in any part of the country to any part of the world, there are certain airlines. It's very interesting to observe that how the airlines from the Middle East, they have really come on the world map, and some of the airlines from the Southeast Asia, they have come to the world map. In fact, over the last 25 years, the top 5 airlines of the world that has changed substantially. There was a time when people used to say Cathay Pacific is the best airlines, or Lufthansa is the best airlines. But today people talk about Singapore Airlines, Emirates, Etihad. They figure as the best airlines in the world. Why? Because they were conscious of the fact that they have to grow to that level, and they have grown to that level. And not only they have grown, they are maintaining their position, the best to serve the world market. So I think that it's a positioning strategy which some of the airlines, which is Singapore Airlines or Malaysian Airlines or Emirates or Etihad, they are really doing that kind of a thing. And some of the airlines of the world, they have lost their position against these airlines in the marketplace in the recent past. The 11th corporate positioning option is value leader, which is best price performance. And here I put it Walmart. I think Walmart is is the number one Fortune 500 company, and it's the largest company perhaps in the Fortune 500 list, which is only on best price performance. That it's likely to come in India. There is a debate about it, but globally, Walmart is seen as the best price performance, and then you have a bargain leader, the lowest prices. Some of the airlines in the world, they are the bargain leader. They give you the cheapest rates. It could be Vishal Mega Mart in India or in Delhi at least. They give you the lowest rates, and that is where I call the last option for any company to position themselves is also valid, which is the bargain leader, that you offer the lowest prices. And friends, these are the 12 corporate positioning options, very, very different. And I have taken you through in detail and given you enough examples. But please don't misunderstand me that I am advocating the view of one company or the other, or discouraging or running down other company. These are purely illustrations and examples for the sake of clarity and for your understanding. And I thought that in the absence of such examples, I may not be able to put across my point very effectively to you. So it's for that reason I took that example. Many companies also feel that they can have undifferentiated marketing strategy. Some companies, they find that they are actually, the demand for their services is so big and so huge, they need not to really go for a segmentation. So they look at their marketing strategy is undifferentiated, a strategy that overlook segments, differences, and use the same marketing mix for all target markets. Like some of the government hospitals, whether the rich goes for treatment or the poor goes for the treatment, they charge the same amount. But some of the private missionary hospitals, for example, they even give free services to the ones who are below the poverty line or the have-nots, and they charge accordingly when they go for a, it's very interesting to observe that same surgery, if you are getting that surgery done and getting admitted in a Janata ward, it costs you less. If you get into private ward, it costs you double. If you get to the fully private nursing home kind of a treatment, same surgery but done by the same doctor at the same theater, it costs you 4 times. But why they do it? Because they get the money from somebody who can afford, but then they give it to the as a charity to the people who also cannot afford it. So that's a model is working in other cases. But the government hospitals, typically they look at undifferentiated kind of a thing. Why positioning, how positioning can work effectively? I think these are the 5 stages which are very critical. The first stage is documenting it. What benefits are the most important to your current and the potential customers? Understand that and document it and be very clear about it. For example, some airlines thought people need on-time arrivals, not departures, but on-time arrivals. If I arrive at my destination on time, I can spend the day, I can plan the day, and then I can spend the day the way I planned it. So some airlines in India and maybe in other parts, they looked at documenting what kind of value propositions could be possible. And then they decided, what image do you want your current and potential customers to have your organizations? And here Indigo, for example, they realized that we will give utmost importance to one, which is on-time arrivals. Differentiating, which competitors do you want to appear different from, and what are the factors that you wish to use to make your organization different from them? So that is where the third stage is, how do you differentiate? The fourth is designing. How will you develop and communicate these differences? And finally, delivering it. that your plan is one part of it, but your execution is another part of it. So how do you deliver it? So delivering, how will you make your goods or services appear different to your customers? So friends, we have gone to the, we have done two strategies. We move to the third one. The third one is product life cycle as a basis of marketing strategy. The suggestion here is that each product goes through a life cycle, each service goes through a life cycle. There is a stage of introduction, there is a stage of growth, there is a stage of maturity, there is a stage of decline. And at each stage, there cannot be different marketing objectives. For example, at the introductory stage of any service, the marketing objectives are to create awareness and trial. Create more awareness and trial. The second is that if once the awareness is there, your service starts growing, then the marketing objectives are maximize market share. How do you maximize market share? Now that is the strategy. The third is the maturity stage, where you find that the everybody or you have achieved the maximum market. Now it is maturing. It doesn't, your sales don't go up. So in that kind of a situation, you look at maximize profits, because you can cut down your cost to maximize profits. And then there is a fourth stage, which we call it a decline stage. And decline stage is actually to milk the cow. Now, in the services sector, I mean, I quickly run through some of my slides to substantiate the point. And please, please now be ready with your questions, as I just have less than 10 minutes to conclude this interaction. So I'll keep some minutes towards the end for your questions. So the marketing objectives at the introductory stage are to create awareness and trial, and you offer the basic products or service. Your costs are cost-based. Your distribution is to build selective distribution, and you use a very extensive advertising and sales promotion. The second stage is growth stage, where the market objective is to maximize market share. So you offer product extensions or warranties. You have a price to penetrate the market. You go for intensive distribution. You advertise to create interest in the mass market, and you reduce the promotions. In the third stage is actually the maturity stage, where you your marketing objectives are to maximize profits, where you diversify brands and models. You come out with different variations, variants, price to match the or beat the competition. You actually go for low prices to meet the competition. You go into more intensive into the market to actually reach out to the untapped markets. Look at Dr. Lal Pathological Lab, where you know they have gone into the gone up to the level of an individual. You make a phone call and they come and pick up the samples from your home. Advertise to stress your brand differences, and you sell promotion to increase to discourage brand switching. And the last is actually the decline stage, where you look at milk the cow. For example, I've taken an example from the products, not from services, just to make my point relevant. Here is a car in this country which is still there on the roads. They don't spend much money in advertising. They don't run promotions, but still the government departments, the taxi fleet owners, the defense sector, and other B2B buyers are buying this car. So there is no point in spending money in this. And finally, there are the fourth strategy is you look at your position as against industry versus competition. So you have an option. We have four options there, that you are a market leader. So maintain your market leader position. Indigo Airlines in this country, they are the market leader. How they're going to maintain that market leader position? They are now going for new aircraft. They are going for new routes. They are revamping their fleet. They are training their staff. They are actually now setting up higher standards of customer service and ensuring that these standards are delivered. And that is what I was told by the corporate office of this airlines, that they are now finding it very difficult to, and they are taking on that challenge to maintain their market leadership position, because new players are entering into the market, and that is the challenge. The second is market challenger, that you as a company, you are challenging. In the communication sector, Samsung challenge Apple, and that is what we have seen it happening. The third option is market follower, and the market follower strategy is that you follow the leader and you don't bother much about it, and you always maintain one step low, and finally you call it market nicher, that you all of a sudden you take a new platform and you go on to a very different platform, and you differentiate from yourself, from the others. So some of the hotels in this country, they've become 7-star hotels to differentiate themselves, gone into a luxury segment, and that is a niche. Luxury definitely is a niche, and the niche by definition means people have highly specialized requirements, and they are willing to pay a premium to get those needs fulfilled. Finally, friends, if I need to summarize, I will say that marketing strategy means you must think in terms of analysis, strategy development, and implementation in developing a vision about the markets of interest to you, and you develop the target market strategies, positioning strategies to meet the value proposition. You set objectives and develop and implement and manage various elements of the marketing program.
Okay, thank you so much, sir, for this presentation. And as we draw to the end, I probably could ask one question in between. Mm-hmm. Is that you talked about the idea of market challenges, say Apple challenges Samsung, and they are competing with one another. But we have often seen in certain advertisements, say in the cola ads, say in the soft drink ads, they try to attack each other in a very unethical way. How is that dealt with? Is that allowed? Say, because they sometimes do a very direct pointing out, say, you know, so and so, maybe Sprite or a Coke or something.
Yeah, one is called ethics. So ethically, it should not happen. But it's also being said that in business, everything is allowed. So everything is fair in love and war. So when companies are competing against the competitors, they do come out with comparison advertisements, and you have seen comparison advertisements for computers, for laptops, for automobiles, for cars, for soft drinks, for even edible salt, for toothpaste, for toothbrushes, and so many product categories. Yes, ethically it should not be done, but companies find that's the only way to do it. And it is happening cut across product categories, in cookies, chocolates, and other product categories. And it's happening.
It is happening. So, and it also draws out a lot of humor also, perhaps.
But if it is not giving you market, then that is useless.
Right.
Your money is going down the drain. You're spending money in running down your competitors, and actually your image is going down.
Right.
So think twice before you actually do that. That is a right. Sort of caution I would like to give.
Right, sir. Okay. Sir, I'm afraid I won't be able to ask any more questions, and perhaps no more questions from the listeners. But thank you for being tuned in, and tomorrow will, as sir said, will be the last lecture on our series, Services Marketing, more specifically on marketing strategies in service sector. So please be tuned in, and I hope you have a nice day, and let's thank sir for being here and sharing his ideas with us. Thank you, sir.